championship round again. In third place, Marshall Holden, the colorful 10-year veteran on the Professional Bowlers Tour from Jacksonville, Oregon. Our second place bowler is another familiar name. A member of the PBA Hall of Fame, winner of 14 PBA titles, Johnny Petraglia. And in the top spot as we enter the championship round, a newcomer in only his 12th PBA tournament, Joe Saldemini from Reno, Nevada. That's our field for today's $125,000 Rolaids Open. And live, we go to that first match. Match number one, head-to-head, Bruce Carter, 5'8", 160 pounds on the right. 26 years old, a non-winner. Bill Straub, the defending champion at 6'5", sits down. And along with you, we'll watch Bruce Carter from Round Rock, Texas. That's a town just north of the capital city of Austin. Carter's first shot. Beautifully done. First championship round appearance of his career, and he starts it in the best way possible. Now Bill Straub of Lincoln, Nebraska. 31 years old, won here last year. Muscles the ball, like my colleague, Bo Burton.
He's a big guy, though. Bill Straub could have played football, even in the pros.
Just plays with that 16-pound ball. And the corner pins of 7 and 10 were a little late in falling. It caused Bill to take a second look. His average on this championship pair was 231, as you look at his stats. Lincoln, Nebraska's home, 255 pounds, 6'5", 31 years of age. Now moving to the left lane, he will try to double. Had a 300 game, Thursday's third round. Florissant, Missouri, a suburb of St. Louis, and Bo, after snow last year, what a difference a year makes. Nearly 70 degrees outside. Look at that reaction.
But the same player out there on the lanes, Bill Straub, the defending champion, starting like he finished last year with a double.
Now Bruce Carter, who averaged 234 on this pair, going for a double to stay even. He's never been to Brooklyn, the borough in New York, but he sure got a second strike that way here.
Chris, the pin action we talked about right at the top of the championship round, sensational. Neither player has been solid in the pocket yet. They have four strikes.
Bruce's highest PBA finish was sixth this year in the opening event, the Miller Classic in Anaheim. He lost in a one-game roll-off to Joe Stanton. Off and running here in Missouri.
Bruce Carter, Chris, a player that we're going to see a lot more of. He's got a good style, strong, 26 years old, tremendous wrist action at the bottom of the swing, good high follow through, desired results on that shot.
Now, the defending champion, Bill Straub, a double up shooting in the third frame. Six strikes, three by each professional in our first match. Things are hot in St. Louis. Here's a farm manager. That means he tries to make projections on weather, crop yield, etc.
Sounds more like a gambler.
That it is. Pin here on the left lane of this championship pair.
With two lefties in the championship round, Johnny Petraglia and Salvamini, we'll see the pinfall of Bill Straub. He almost trips the four, two pins to the sideboard, doesn't quite get it. The first time someone's hit the pocket and not struck so far today.
All right, let's, as we look at his wife, Barbara, pretty girl. And that's the way. Bill Straub shot the four pin. So, three strikes and a spare. Trailing by one pin, we're going to take a break here to Here a message from one of our sponsors.
Roger.
And Cresta from Switzerland. That follows the Professional Bowlers Tour telecast. Now we're following Bruce Carter. Leads by one. He has a three-bagger up shooting in the fourth. High on the head pin coming up and left the three.
Chris, a multiplicity of strikes we've seen so far, plus a good break by Bruce Carter going right through the nose and voiding the split. That's part of the great pin action we've seen all week long, is that the ball goes right through the heart. Look at this ball. Normally we see a 4-6 or 6-7 split. All of a sudden, the pins stay down real low, drive out the four pin, a very simple spare, the three.
And getting the three pin, despite sticking at the line, the 26-year-old from Round Rock, Texas. He's earned a little over $5,000 thus far this year. And the loser of this first game will pick up a check for $5,000, but the winner in our stepladder format has a chance to take another step toward the $20,000 first prize in this, the Rolaids Open. Carefully setting his grip, concentrating. That one just slid by, leaving the 1-2-4-8.
The one thing we have to guard against today when the lanes are very slick, as they are here at Dick Weber Lane, is watch out that the conditioner or oil doesn't get in the thumb hole. Sometimes when you pick up the ball, it'll get on the thumb, Chris, the ball will just slip right off your hand at the point of release. That's what happened to Bruce on that shot.
Good point, Bo, as we look at Carol Carter, mother of Christopher, 17 months old.
And she's studying to be an architect. In fact, as soon as she passes, she'll be a full-fledged architect in Texas.
All right. Her husband, Bruce, marked with his second spare after striking three times. This is a man, Straub, who has that knee brace.
Automobile accident, Chris. In January, he's taking his University of Nebraska bowling team out to Las Vegas, had an accident, and that's what happened.
Lucky to survive, Bill Straub.
No one else hurt in the accident, Chris. He rolled a van over three times. The players were all right. Bill suffered a dislocated kneecap, and that's the reason he wears the brace, to rectify and help it to keep from getting too tired.
Part-time pro. Bill's first championship round appearance this year, he finished 53rd in the season opening event in the Miller Classic, 102nd AC Delco. So it strikes like that that has put him in the number four position in our field of five today, and now gives him a 14-pin lead with the shades. That's our host, Dick Weber. What a remarkable recovery from surgery. Those tiny guys are tough, Bo.
Well, and he's telling me right before we went on the air he's going to start practicing in another week, so he's well on his way to a full recovery.
Spare up, Carter. Well, somewhat of a break as he left the nine pin.
Bruce Carter with that five-step delivery. Doesn't take much slide at the foul line. He kind of plants with that left foot as he comes through. That's step four right here. Now watch that left slide foot. Stops almost immediately. We'll watch Marshall Holman when he comes on in the next match, how he slides much farther in the release point.
Carter, who has won four regional titles, but not a national. It did come up. So a while it looked as though it was going to go by. Bruce Carter, 26 years old, a carpenter, a cabinet maker. Gee, I wonder if he and his wife travel. We need some work done back in Indiana.
Well, best of all, he's a professional bowler, Chris, and
yes.
He is really a star on the horizon. This is his first championship round, but we're going to see a lot more of Bruce Carter. He's got his head together. He's a good, disciplined athlete, and he has a great bowling game.
Carter getting that strike in the seventh frame and now trailing by 15 as we take this break for this message.
I used to think.
There he is, the flamboyant, colorful, great champion, Marshall Holman, who will meet the winner of this match. Then it's Johnny Petraglia. Then it's the tournament leader, Joe Salvemini of Reno, Nevada. Right now, Lincoln, Nebraska's Bill Straub, leading by 15, a double up, seventh frame. Again, spring three in this $125,000 Rolaids Open. 20 to the winner, 11 to runner-up, third 75, 6 for fourth, and 5,000 to the unfortunate loser of this first game.
Bill Straub, when he has it, as he looks like he has it out there now, is almost unstoppable. One of the really strong, powerful bowling balls rolled out here on the Pro Bowlers Tour. When he keeps it in the pocket, look out.
He looks away, Carter. It just didn't come up.
Lovely Barbara looks on. She's just as sweetheart and as delightful in person as she looks on the television screen. Bill has left himself a difficult spare here, the 2-8, especially when I said the surface friction of the lane is very low. A lot of lane conditioner oil out there. It's difficult to go by. In fact, in the match play, Bill and I came to a situation where he needed the spare to defeat me, and it was one of my few victories as he slid by it on the right. Has to guard against that on this shot.
All right. And Nelson Burton, who finished 13th here in the Rolaids Open, as we once again see Bruce Carter, that non-winner, PBA member for 3 years.
Very important shot right here. He trails by 23, has a strike working eighth frame, can cut the lead down to 13 with just two frames remaining.
Using nearly all of the approach. Oh, a high hit. 6-7-10. The last thing he wanted here in this first match.
Just cuts right through the heart. He had a good break on that shot in the sixth frame where he hit high and left just the three pin. This time, no such break, leaves the 6-7-10. Not as tough on these type of conditions as it is normally, Chris, because he needs to slide the six pin over to the seven.
Close. What a disastrous open frame coming late in this first match against the defending champion, Bill Straub. So now he'll be shooting in the ninth. 35 pin deficit.
Just about a must situation for Bruce Carter. The best he can do is 222. Bill Straub going at a 237 pace through eight frames.
It's very little consolation, but as we indicated, he finished sixth as we look at Straub. Carter finished sixth in the Miller Classic in Anaheim, now taking one of the three re-racks that he is allowed. And appears today that he'll be finishing fifth in this field of five.
Chris, we talk about the great pin action, but sometimes you pay a penalty. Very unusual hit, the powerful ball of Bruce Carter cutting through the 3-pound, 3-ounce pins used here at Dick Weber Lanes leaves the solid nine. His wife Carol looks on dejectedly. The five pin actually chops straight back off the nine, quite unusual.
Carol, being a draftsperson, soon to be a licensed architect, supports her husband Bruce on the tour, but today it'll be 5,000. Him. Straub now shooting in the ninth with a spare up. And Marshall Holman, who will meet the winner of this match, keeps warming up.
Example of powerful bowling. You see the high revolution ball of Bill Straub digging right into the 1-3, driving through, almost left the solid nine. See how little resistance those pins are for that polyurethane ball that Straub is using today.
Bill won here last year, defeating Mike Albee 217 to 212. That's his second four of this first match. But doesn't matter. Bill Straub, the defending champion, will move up the ladder, and his opponent will be Marshall Holman, the professional bowlers tour. We'll continue after this message from one of our sponsors, and then station identification. Stay tuned. All right, we're live from Dick Weber Lane's Florissant, Missouri. The roll aids open. The first match has ended. Bill Straub, with eight strikes, shoots a 237 to Bruce Carter's 202. He finished the match with a strike and a spare in the 10th. So now, Straub, the defending champion, goes against a 14-time titleist, Marshall Holman of Jacksonville, Oregon. That's our second match as we bring you live coverage from Florissant, Missouri. Practice balls continue here, and that was Marshall Holman, the 5'9", 140-pound, 28-year-old pro from Oregon. So here he goes against Straub. The handshake.
Comparison in size, big Bill Straub against Marshall Holman, but not much comparison in power. Marshall Holman, one of the great power players on the professional bowlers tour, going against a man with a hot hand, defending champion Bill Straub.
First shot in our second match, perfect, Bill Straub. And if you just joined us, he defeated Bruce Carter, 237 to 202. Now, we look at Marshall Holman, his second appearance in the championship finals this year. Remember 3 weeks ago in the Showboat Invitational, he finished fifth, losing in the opening match to two-time champion Gary Skidmore. And that one didn't come up, leaving the 2-4-5, and we could see that occasionally here in this match.
I agree, Chris. They both play deep inside. Watch the line of Marshall Holman, and believe me, these lanes are slick. They have a lot of conditioner on them. It just shows how much power Holman has in that wrist. He's almost around the third arrow. That was a little too deep. You see that ball accelerate backwards at the pine or the 15-foot mark out there and not finish for the bucket.
2-4-5. Okay. Marshall early seems unhappy with that first frame, and this is one thing that he has to defeat within himself.
He's a maturing man out there, Chris. I spent some time with him this week here at the Roll Aids, and Marshall knows he's got to change his attitude, and he believes that he can be a winner and still be a nice guy and aggressive at the same time. We may see that today if he gets some strikes.
That's beautiful timing and tempo. Okay. If you're looking for a smile, you won't get one.
Watch the head pin. It'll go to the left sideboard. This is for Marshall Holman. He drives it to the left sideboard. Then here it comes. The messenger, the scout, whatever you may call it, comes all the way around and drives out the 10. Only with power and speed and great ability can you achieve a strike like that.
Now Straub. He opened with a strike. Second frame. It looked like a light hit. The ball that wasn't coming up, he gets them all. A double. And that's a quick 10-10 lead here in our second match.
Bill Straub, if he does not defend his Roll Aids title here this week, will become a rabbit and go back on the rabbit squad. Because he isn't a touring pro, he only gets a one-year exemption from the rabbit squad. He must re-qualify today with a win.
Only 9 events last year. Oh, yes, the 1-2-4-10.
The ball just slides by, Chris, the washout. And what it is, the characteristic of the championship pair is showing up. The left-hand lane a little slicker, a little tighter, just by the grain of the wood and the pine. Straub not getting the complete lift on that shot, slides by, has a difficult washout spare.
His wife watches. You saw that it's an open frame now for Bill Straub in the third frame.
Bill Straub with that washout should have got the ball over in this area right here and driven the head pin over into the 10-pin area to knock out the washout. He didn't quite come up, leaves two pins left.
And now Marshall Holman, with a strike up, can jump on an 8-pin lead and increase it.
Grateful. Marshall Holman with that double leads by 18.
Marshall has been in a championship round slump in the last couple of years. It hasn't won in over a year on ABC television. Gets the first great break I've seen him in over a year. An unusual strike of the head pin again did the damage. Went to the sideboard and tripped out the two. Holman, 18-pin lead. What a break.
Okay, averaging 214 this year. Last year he won the George Young High Average Award at 216. Break that time, leaving the 4-7 on the left lane. Trying his stroke, his follow through there as he comes back. A couple of checkpoints. His earnings thus far this year, his career earnings, and on that list he is 6th. Only his 10th year as a professional. 14 victories. 4-7. Speed to spare, and a constantly practicing Marshall Holman with a 16-pin lead. We're going to take a break. We'll be back. Open continues with the defending champion Bill Straub trailing by 16, shooting in the fourth frame after an open. He's going against Marshall Holman. He's on the right lane of this championship pair. Lots of loft on that shot. Beautifully done. 6'5". Now to the left-hander, not quite so big, but a great champion, Bo.
Thank you, Chris. The man in second place. And, John, what do you see out there on the right side, and what do you expect on the left in your next match?
Well, it looks like there might be a little bit of carry down on the right side, Bo. I'm going to have to see. The soft rubber ball is working in practice, but if they're breaking down, I'm going to have to go to this 20-year-old plastic ball to keep it online.
What he means by breaking down, Chris, the oil is drying up. They're starting to hook more. John's going to go with an old ball if he has a problem. Back to you.
And Bill Straub crossing over, thinking that he might get them all. We have a spinning pin and leaves a 6-pin. John Petraglia, native of Brooklyn, now living in New Jersey, will bowl the winner of this, the second game. Bill Straub won the first game 237 to 202, and Bill had 8 strikes, one of 5 300s bowled this week. Bill getting his in his third round on Thursday. 6-pin. Okay. Continuing to mark, Bill Straub. There you see the difference in size, Straub and Holman. And here are the leading winners this year. Look at that. Tom Milton with 30. Gary Skidmore just close behind. And Toby Contreras, Guppy Troop, and Wayne Webb.
Contreras just missed by 4 pins. Webb an injury. He had to withdraw.
And Marshall Holman alternating strikes and spares now.
This is the first time, Chris, that we have seen Marshall Holman loose and in the driver's seat in over a year. He's had some bad luck in championship rounds. He's beat himself in championship rounds, and I know he's got to be thinking about it out there. What can happen now? Right now, with a strike, he will have Bill Straub on the ropes.
U.S. Open champion, Firestone Tournament of Champions winner among his 14. 2-15 on TV. Marshall getting that double and increasing his lead to 26 pins against Bill Straub. Lincoln, Nebraska bowler, assistant coach of the University of Nebraska bowling team. You'd think it would go.
Bill Straub's carry percentage for a game and a half is 76% of balls in the pocket, and we've found so far this year that to win the PBA title, you have to carry above 90%. Nobody's won with an average below 90%. Straub well below that right now. He's got to get it going.
Now cross lane for the 10 pin. This is in the 6th frame of the second match. All right. Earlier, we had an opportunity to ask Straub about his knee problems and how it affects his game.
My problem is my kneecap has been dislodged. I'm on medication to hold down the discomfort, but my leg gets exceedingly tired, especially after having bowled for a half a dozen or a dozen games. The problem is that late at night when the lanes start to hook and I have to plant my left leg to really get through the shot, it becomes difficult to do at times.
And Chris, the medication is just the aspirin type, which really doesn't affect his coordination, but it does relieve the pain.
Good point. And the 255-pounder comes up with a 310 on the left lane. So after a 237 in the first game, Straub against Holman is having his problems.
Cross lane, good lesson to be learned by Bill Straub's spear shooting ability. He throws that big, powerful ball, but watch how he attacks the spear. He takes completely to the left side of the approach and uses all the angle he can to avoid the chop of the three away from the 10.
Bowling team should take that as a tip from their coach, Bill Straub. Second match, we'll be back for more after this.
We're in a wrestling match, Chris.
Okay. Well, Marshall Holman can't believe that one. That was on the right lane.
This is about the time we've seen Marshall start having his problems. Match well in hand, had a nice lead, and now he's got a difficult 2-8 spare, especially on the very slick lanes.
Don't you have another pal out here, Billy Walden, that could wrestle a grizzly bear?
Tough Billy Walden shot one of the 300s bowled in the championship this week from Troy, Missouri.
Oh, got the sleeper. Boy, did he give a little body English at the line, Marshall Holman.
As we said, double wood. You have to be very careful to get the back pin with the powerful ball that Marshall Holman rolls. It's not as much of a problem. Control is his problem. Carry is usually never his problem. Did it very easily on that shot. Right now, Holman going at a 216 pace. Bill Straub, 189.
The right of your screen, that's Dick Weber. A little light after surgery and hospitalization, but he's on the mend. Former mail carrier brought me a letter today. Oh, a break. Only the 7 now to knock down.
Chris, you know the psychology of sports as well as anybody, and it has to be going through Marshall's mind when the bad things are going to start to happen.
That's right.
He almost gets one here, what we call the swishing 7-10. He just gets a break on the 10 pin.
Bo, he appears to me to be one of the great psych artists on the tour.
He used to be. Everybody's been whipping on him so much lately, they got his number. He wants to just get it back into winning. He doesn't care about psyching him.
Oh, he's a complex, lovely guy, really. Marshall Holman. And he still has a 26-pin lead, but that's spare in the 8th frame. There he is at the line.
Apprehension coming up. Look at that face. That's when the old 10-pin fell down.
Could have been an aerialist with Ringling Brothers Barnum and Bailey.
His
coordinated.
His father was a pole sitter.
Right. That high hit finally gets Bill Straub of Lincoln, Nebraska strike. That was in the 8th frame. Boy, does he ever need them now.
Straub backed into a must situation. He can cut that lead down to just 16 here in the 9th frame. He has a possible 219 game if he fills with strikes. Holman going in at just a 215 pace. It could go down to the 10th.
And then just said, no way. Well, how do we make the 210?
The 210, Chris, you must hit the 2-pin on the left side of the pin over in this area and slide it over into the 10-pin area right here, either to the sideboard or directly into the 10-pin.
It's a gentle kiss of that 2, huh?
Well, you have two ways to go, directly at it or right off the sideboard.
Okay.
A must shot.
In the second second match for Bill Straub, his wife Barbara, after winning the first game 237 to Bruce Carter's 202, his second open frame. And Marshall Holman, who finished third in this field of five, now in the ninth frame, spare up. Foundation strike for the man from Oregon.
Our statistician, Mike Durbin, says that Marshall Holman needs just one pin and two shots to win his first championship round game on ABC's Pro Bowlers Tour in more than a year. I think you'll get this one.
I bet. And like the great champion that he is, he got them all. So Marshall Holman will go against the first of two southpaws. Left-hander Johnny Petraglia, now bowling out of New Jersey, will be up next. We'll be back.
In business, some people want to look good at any cost.
Send this to headquarters by one of those overnight systems.
It's about...
Straub is eliminated, getting a $6,000 check after winning the first, shot only a 164. Marshall Holman with a big, important 232, so he'll go against Johnny Petraglia. Okay, a few years ago, there were many, many cities battling for the National Bowling Hall of Fame. St. Louis won, and rather fittingly, because they've had great bowling teams, great bowling champions, and three of whom are right here, including Ray Bluth, and you met Bo Burton and Dick Weber a little bit earlier. Well, we'd like to show you footage of the progress of the building of the National Bowling Hall of Fame, which is just adjacent to the home of the St. Louis Cardinals, the champions. This is going to be a great tribute to the game of bowling, and I'm proud to be the honorary chairman of the drive. And Bruce Pluckhahn, the executive director, is proud of what is being built right downtown. And here at the Crossroads of America, a lot of people will be seeing the artifacts that will be inside. Okay, now let's go to the Rolaids tip of the week. And today it's on spare making. And Bo Burton is going to concentrate on how to cover the 3-6-10 combination, and then 6 alone and the 10 alone. So watch, it'll improve your game. Here's Bo.
The Professional Bowler's Tip of the Week is brought to you by Rolaids.
Without incorporating today's tip, it is impossible to become a good bowler. We've designed a color-coded system for spares on the right-hand side of the lane. First, you must move to the left side of the approach, face the target. This increases the angle for spares on the right-hand side. Now I'm going to shoot the right-hand side base spare, the 3-6-10. In making the spares on the right side, you follow the old bowling tip that tells you to use the third arrow, designated by the blue tape, whenever the head pin is knocked down. To make the 6-10, I move three boards to the left from the base position on the approach, as designated by the red tape. For the 10 pin only, the same principles apply. I move three boards farther to the left on the approach, yet my target, the blue tape on the third arrow, remains the same. Remember these three things. Move to the left on the approach, use the principles of your color code system, the third arrow target, and you'll make all of the spares on the right-hand side of the lane.
Roger Staub.
Game with a score of 232 to Bill Straub's 164. Straub winning the first game over Bruce Carter, no relation to the great Don Carter, 237 to 202. Holman will shoot first. This for the right to meet the tournament leader, Joe Salvenema, knee for the $20,000 first prize. Okay, and the adrenaline should be pumping now. 28-year-old Holman. Petraglia doesn't look it, but he's 35. Born in Brooklyn. Finished fifth in last year's Long Island Open.
To 6-7 split, Chris. He just turned the ball a little too much. John, as we all know, is a cranker on the left side, that low profile. He holds the ball down low right there when he wants to turn it a lot. He just got a little too much on his very first shot. Has left himself a difficult split to start the match.
All right, this is the way John Petraglia goes for it. Fortunately, leaves the seven. Another left-hander, Earl Anthony, finished 36th here in the Rolaids Open.
Johnny Petraglia just sliding by the two-pin. He wanted to drive it over. The one penalty of the big hook.
Mm-hmm. Petraglia of old. Just one of two players to have won the Triple Crown, PBA National, U.S. Open, Firestone. Billy Hardwick was the other. We're speaking of Petraglia, of course. Here's a man that has won two parts of it, tournament champions in the U.S. Open, Marshall Holman. He opened with a strike, now shooting in the second frame of our semifinal next-to-last game. Big double.
Marshall Holman, who is taking martial art lessons from Johnny Petraglia out here, Chris. We know Johnny Petraglia used to own a karate training center in New York area. And since selling that, he's interested mainly the players in it. Holman is one of his best students. And right now, Holman's giving a little bowling lesson as Marshall has a 21-pin lead through two frames.
And black belt wearer Petraglia can only sit and watch. Holman with a double up shooting in the third frame. This is a skier also. High hit, leaving the four.
Marshall just jumped all over that ball, trying to get the big lead. Left the four pin, didn't get the trip off the two pin from the sideboard. This will be a tough match. Both these players are two of the greatest that ever put on a pair of bowling shoes, picked up a bowling ball, and they're heady players. Neither one of them can be intimidated or defeated. They might get beat, but they'll never lose.
Between them, 28 championships. Drafter double, marking with a spare in the third.
Cross lane, Marshall Holman, action line tracer right over the third arrow, just like we see most of the great pros use the third arrow for all spares with the head pin down.
Petraglia elected to the PBA Hall of Fame last year, former president of the PBA. And that was a big double. John Petraglia.
The can opener, John just sawed out the hole back in to let the five pin drive straight through the four and seven, just torn out with all that spin lift on the ball. He's in position to even the match with one more strike.
Man that spent 2 years in Vietnam, won five titles in 1971. This semifinal match will continue between Petraglia and Holman after this.
Baseball star Jim Palmer.
I hate dandruff.
Can Tegrin control Jim Palmer's dandruff for 3 days without shampooing?
3 days?
Tegrin test, day one.
And Marshall getting that big strike here in the semifinal game. The winner to go into the championship.
Marshall using a little rosin. That's excellent to use, especially when there's a lot of lane conditioner or oil on the lanes, to keep that oil from building up around the thumb and fingers. You have to have a good grip to get the lift on the ball. Marshall, a semi-fingertip grip. Johnny Petraglia uses the fingertip.
Trying to end the television jinx dating back to his last title nearly 2 years ago in the King Louis Open in March of 1981. So the pressure now is on Johnny Petraglia, the left-hander. Tournament leader Joe Salvenemy is a left-hander as well.
Coming right at you, there's Marshall Holman from a unique camera angle. In fact, that's beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
I love it. Thank you, Bob Lanning. That was the best shot Marshall's thrown in a number of years on championship round two. Look at that.
High hit, leaving only the two. So it breaks his string of strikes here in the semifinal game.
Chris, John using that gold ball. It's over 20 years old, and it's the only ball authorized to be used in professional tournament competition with metal flakes in it. The reason that being, I think the manufacturer just made a mistake and got enough power to get it past.
Okay. Pretty bowling ball. So now Petraglia marking with a spare in the fifth frame, trailing by 11. His opponent, Marshall Holman, has that double up. But meanwhile, Petraglia drying the hands and getting that gold bowling ball.
It's really a polyester bowling ball, very similar to the red ones we see out here quite often. The metal is down about a quarter of an inch in the ball, so it really has no effect on the outer roll.
Four pin.
Once again, we look at that angle. Watch Johnny Petraglia, that left shoulder open up. Gets the good, powerful lift. I'll tell you what, he threw that ball really well. He's just not playing the lane the proper way. Remember, he only got four practice balls before he came out. After almost an hour's delay, he's a little bit confused right now.
And that camera angle we just used shows the loneliness of the sport. God, you're out there on that approach all by yourself. Tough head-to-head competition. And we're glad you've enjoyed these telecasts. This is the 22nd year. Marshall Holman's wheels. Three-bagger for Marshall Holman here in the semifinals.
Marshall uses the full approach, and one of the keys to Marshall's delivery is see how he walks to the left on his first two steps. That lines up his shoulder with the target. Then he just saw a perfect shot as he slides through the shot and releases the ball while he's still on the slide. With that particular shot, he opened up a 22-pin lead. He has a three-bagger working.
What a slide. Now he'll attempt it on the left lane of this championship pair, where Marshall had a 256 average. Petraglia at 246. Holman has it all together now here in his second match. He won the last one, 232 over Bill Straub's 164. A break in this action, but we'll be back to bring you more in a moment.
Really now, how can you tell if you're buying a quality paint? You can't kick it like a tire or squeeze it like bathroom tissue. But there is one way. You can buy Glidden, a brand that's been proving and improving its quality since 1872. In fact, now you can buy famous Glidden Spread Satin for only $9.99, the same low price as last year. Glidden, we keep our promises in the can.
Only Old Spice gives you two-fisted protection with original Old Spice deodorant and Super Dry antiperspirant. Both have that famous Old Spice scent. So what's the difference? Old Spice deodorant helps knock out odor. And Old Spice antiperspirant fights odor while it helps wipe out wetness. And they both work overtime. Old Spice, one name that gives you two-fisted protection.
The tournament leader is Joe Salvemini. He will meet the winner of this match. What pressure on this 27-year-old, because it's his first championship round appearance of his career. And he's going to have to go against one of two pros, each having won 14 titles. Petraglia down by 32. Shooting in the seventh frame, a spare working.
Johnny with that great leverage, powerful ball he's always been known for. Watch the position of the swing as he comes through right next to the body, then right next to that right leg, almost brushes the pants. That's good direction, and he needed all that leverage as he just tore the rack right apart. He's now in position to cut the lead of Marshall Holman to down to 22 pins. He needs this strike.
Petraglia, born in Brooklyn, now from Manalapan, New Jersey.
The father-to-be, Johnny Petraglia, got the first real good break of the match. He tripped the 6-10 out with the three-pin going very high. He's put some pressure on Holman. The lead is now just 22 pins, two frames left.
In 10 years, Marshall Holman has won over $500,000, sixth on the all-time money list. His opponent, Petraglia, eighth on the list with $529,000.
One of the benefits of light pins, most people talk about the strikes, but of a little heavier pin right there, Chris, he'd have had the dinner bucket, the 2-4-5-8. Instead, he just has a 2-4, a very simple spare. What a turnaround. I would say that the lighter pins and the good pin action add at least 7 or 8 pins to a pro bowler's average over a period of a year. These players average around 215, with a heavier pin, it'd be down around 208.
What will the lighter pins do for an amateur bowler?
Well, the lighter pins can have almost a negative effect on an amateur bowler. Sometimes they don't learn to develop enough leverage to knock down pins and consistently improve their game. So you should always get good coaching and try to bowl against a little tougher pinfall every once in a while. One practice vehicle the pros often use is to use a lighter ball when they're practicing, say a 13 or 14 pounder. That makes the pins feel like they're a lot heavier.
Okay, now Marshall Holman. Shooting in the ninth, a spare working. Big strike. So now Petraglia is up. And he has a double working for him.
Critical shot for John Petraglia. Can cut Marshall Holman's lead down to just 10 pins with one frame to go if he can strike here in the ninth.
He's on the right lane. Here's the shot. This is championship caliber bowling. John Petraglia coming up with a three-bagger, that strike in the ninth frame, and now 10 pins separating the two winners.
What more can you say about Petraglia? He throws his best balls when he really needs it. Right now, with another strike, the match would be all even. There is no way he can shut out Holman. Even if he strikes out, Holman still can win the match in the 10th.
Went to Springfield, Missouri on that run out.
He doesn't know the cost of baby shoes yet. His child isn't expected till September, but he has just made himself back in the match. Johnny Petraglia with another strike would take a 10-pin lead. He has never been ahead in this match at any one point. It is all even.
This for the right to go into the final game against Joe Salvenemy.
Critical count loss. Johnny Petraglia with a spare will beat a 234 with the spare as he cuts right through the heart, leaves the 247. Right now he is with a conversion here. He'll make Marshall Holman at least spare and get an 8 count.
Okay. So it's a 234 for Johnny Petraglia. That's great shooting, but here's the man that's been up to the test, having won the last game over Bill Straub, 232 to 164, Marshall Holman.
Needs a mark of any type and a good count. to win the match. Just made a smart move. He just sat down and said, see, Chris, that oil is built up in the thumb hole, and plus the pressure of the has allowed a little perspiration to get on his hand. He doesn't want the ball to slip by. A strike a winner, a spare an 80's a winner.
Okay.
An open, he's a loser.
Oh, yes, there are two pins standing down there on the right lane, Nelson.
Almost unbelievable, Chris. Marshall got here with his great pinfall, but for the very first time, he's got a bad break. He must go right between the four and five, get the ball right in that area to convert the spare. There's no way to slide it over. He's got to go right between them. If he doesn't make it, he loses the match. He must make this spare.
Okay, he's on the right lane. Sigh of relief, John Petraglia. And Marshall Holman, still bitten by the snake here on television. So it'll be Petraglia going with Sal Zinnemann for the $20,000 first prize, Marshall Holman, $7,500. Now let's go back to New York. ABC Central and our colleague Jim McKay.
Okay, thanks very much, Chris. That was really some exciting match, wasn't it? Well, in college basketball, last night there was something pretty exciting. The University of Nevada, Las Vegas, the nation's only unbeaten major college team, entertained San Jose State. It was a Pacific Coast Athletic Conference matchup. They were trailing 46-41 with 15 minutes remaining in the game, but then the running Rebels outscored San Jose State 14-4 over the next 6 minutes. There was Larry Anderson hitting for three of his game-high 28 points. Las Vegas, you know, is ranked number one by the AP Writers' Poll this week, but only number two by the UPI Coaches' Poll, and that has been a matter of some controversy in college basketball. No question about that. However, there is no question they won their 23rd game against no defeats last night. University of Nevada, Las Vegas. Now, the World Cup, Alpine World Cup skiing circuit is dormant this week. Dormant to allow all of those athletes to return to their home countries for their national championships. Now, for the American athletes, this meant a trip to Copper Mountain, Colorado. This afternoon, Tamara McKinney, who is currently second in the World Cup standings, had a very successful weekend wrapped up by capturing the giant slalom title. She won the slalom yesterday. As for Phil Mary, lost the giant slalom on Thursday to a fellow little-known Tiger Shaw, but he came back yesterday to win the slalom by almost four full seconds. So he is still a champion with that more of the World Cup season still to come. In fact, we'll be seeing him a week from tomorrow on same-day coverage of Alpine Ski Racing World Cup from Sweden. Coming up, ABC's Wide World of Sports, and on that, we're going to be seeing marvelous Marvin Hagler in that defense of his title last week. We'll also be seeing the Indoor Dream Mile live from Cleveland and the International Toboggan Championship from the famous Cresta Run at Samaritz, Switzerland. Right now, however, we're going to take a commercial break. Word from your local stations. Back to bowling.
And it's all mine. Bring your thirsty self right here. You've got the time, we've got the beer for what you have in mind.
Oh,
welcome to Miller Time. Yours is mine.
The best beer for the best time of the day. Miller High Life.
Four starts, stalling. Gas line freeze, plain gas line antifreeze often isn't enough. Get STP gas treatment. It works three ways to tune up your gas. STP gas treatment surrounds water and removes it. Unlike plain gas antifreeze, it also helps clear the entire fuel system and cleans the carburetor for better mileage. Satisfaction guaranteed. Don't get stopped cold. Use STP gas treatment regularly and tune up your gas.
Punishment at prime in America. Monday, watch ABC's World News Tonight.
Does anyone have a great American car at the right price?
We do!
The Renault Alliance. The Alliance looks like a winner, performs like a winner. It's 1983 Motor Trend Car of the Year. Built in America and it's priced right. $55.95. Now get 11.9% financing to qualified buyers at participating AMC Jeep Renault dealers. Who makes the right deals? Your local AMC Jeep Renault dealers. The right guys.
The right guys!
Do you have Blue Cross and Blue Shield coverage? If you don't, you can sign up this month. If you live in the southern New York State area, you're eligible, but you must sign up before February 28th. No age restrictions, but you must hurry. Open enrollment ends February 28th. Sign up for Blue Cross and Blue Shield coverage now. Call 212-683-3400 for full information. That's 212-683-3400.
Shaft, tonight at 11:45.
Okay, you'd have to see it to believe it. Appearing to be on his road to victory, Marshall Holman left a four of the 4-5 combination and lost to John Petraglia. 234 to 225, and Petraglia now goes against another left-hander in the final, Joe Salvemini of Reno, Nevada. And there they are. Final match, 20,000 the winner, 11,000 the runner-up for the Rolaids Open Championship here at Dick Weber's Lanes in Florissant, Missouri. Petraglia shooting first.
In the last seven PBA tournaments, left-handers have bowled for the title three times. There has been no winners. We're guaranteed a left-handed winner this week.
Right. Undoubtedly buoyed by that last-minute victory while seated as Marshall Holman bowled, Petraglia gets an opening frame strike in the championship match. Now, our first look at this 27-year-old professional from Reno, Nevada. First championship round appearance of his career. Highest ever, 33rd in the Miller High Life Classic. All right. Oh, look at that deep sigh. That's a big relief, striking in the first frame for this non-winner.
His goal to the number one spot, Chris, reminded me of Toby Contreras, who won the AC Delco Classic the second week out here on the tour. He was cool. He was impeccable in the clutch. He just threw it in there every time. I asked him before we went on the air today, is he nervous? He says, I was nervous last night, but it doesn't seem to affect his game. This young man is tough.
Now on the left lane. All but the six pin for this fine high school athlete in Nevada, California. Played basketball, football, and golf as we recheck the pinfall on that shot.
Salvemini going up high, throws the three pin to the sideboard. If he had just a little more speed on the ball, he'd have tripped out the six and the ten. Unfortunately, the three only takes out the ten. He has an easy spare.
A young man that bowled in only one event last year gets a spare in the second frame. Now Petraglia, 14-time champion, triple crown winner, strike up second frame. So Petraglia in this championship game goes out to a 10-pin lead.
Could have bet a dollar, dime to a dollar on that one, Chris. If Johnny Petraglia with an opening to take the lead on the unexperienced young player that he's bowling against, he'll like this turkey right here. This is the style that Dick Weber had so great. He loved to come running out of the gate and have the player chase after him. Come on, Johnny.
Dick Weber, of course, did not bowl in his tournament here, but his son John did and finished 32nd, and Pete finished 78th.
Exact same shot that young Salvemini had on the very first time. He went up high, left the 6-10. John didn't trip out the 10 with the 3-pin. Very easy spare across lane.
Now he opened with a strike, marked with a spare in the second, now shooting in the third. Leaving a four pin on the right lane, this mechanic desk manager for Brunswick Sterling Village Lanes in Reno,
Joe Salvemini. Chris. He has been bowling fairly well this year. As you can see, his average is over 200 for the events he's bowled in, but he has failed to make the rabbit squad, or the squad for the unseated players that the players bowl on Monday. There's only about 70 seated players out here, and approximately 200 rabbits go to the starting gate shooting for the other 90 spots every week.
Okay.
The rabbit squad is just a term that we use out here in the tour. It's actually the pro tour qualifier, where the ineligible players have to earn their way on the tour. Once they get enough points in their first year, if they do well in the tournaments, they are exempt. And this is how you get points up in the championship round.
Ben's dancing off the deck. Sal Venemy getting a strike, this one in the fourth frame. We're in the championship match. More of it following this.
There's more to John Hancock than life insurance.
John Hancock has always taken care of families, but they can also help a family business with a broad range of financial services like group life and health plans, tax planning, IRAs.
Even leasing arrangements for a fleet of delivery trucks.
You know, you could say that John Hancock can really help a family business grow.
John Hancock, we can help you here and now, not just hereafter.
I do one thing, magic. And the secret to being the best is concentrating on one thing, like Kentucky Fried Chicken. They concentrate on making chicken taste magical. I don't know what their secret is, but I know it's something only Kentucky Fried Chicken can do. They make the chicken appear, and we make it disappear.
Kentucky Fried Chicken, we do chicken right.
Next week, we'll be televising from another river city on the Illinois River, Peoria, the $150,000 True Value Open, then the Cleveland Open in Ohio, and 3 weeks from today, the big PBA National Championship, the Toledo Trust PBA Championship in Toledo. Back here to Overland Park, Kansas for the King Louis Open. 4 big weeks on the Professional Bowlers Tour telecast. This is the bowling ball of John Petraglia. Spare up shooting in the fourth. John Petraglia, whom we asked what happened to him in Anaheim, California.
In Anaheim, I got off to a real good start, and then on Wednesday night at 4 o'clock in the morning, I woke up with real bad pains and I got a kidney stone. I had to get my two roommates, Dave Davis and Kenny Hall, out of bed. They rushed me to the hospital. And I finally got rid of it about, 10 o'clock in the morning, but it was too late to be able to do anything in the tournament.
Petraglia recovered from that ailment and doubles here. That strike in the fifth frame of this title match.
John was in the top five in that tournament when that unfortunate happening happened. Joe Salvemini. He's been tough in the clutch all week long. He needs this strike to close down Petraglia's lead.
Oh, the seven pin. Trying to cut it back to nine pins. Difference of 9,000, winning or losing in this one head-to-head game.
The one little fault that we saw Joe have during the week was his inability to consistently make the seven pin. He has to make it right now to keep Petraglia close in the match.
That was a spare in the fifth. Trailing by 19, he'll be shooting in the sixth frame coming up. He just joined us in earlier matches. Straub defeated Carter, 237 to 202. Then Holman over Straub, 232 to 164. And then Johnny Petraglia, 234 to Marshall Holman's 225. Yeah.
coming right at you. Our camera angle that I love so much. You see the left shoulder open up of Joe Salvemini. Makes an excellent shot. By far his best shot so far in the match. Struck there in the sixth.
Petraglia with a double up. All but the six. Check the pin action.
John, the first time he's hit the pocket today, he didn't strike. Three pin goes to sideboard, knocks out the 10, doesn't get the 6. Right now, he's in over the 90% range in pocket percentage and pocket carry. No winner this year has been under 90%.
That's Bear coming in the sixth frame, now leading by 18 pins, as you see. Next week, the True Value Open in Peoria, Illinois. Ray Becker's landmark lanes.
And Art Trask, who had one of the 5 300 games rolled here at Dick Weber. Dick Weber's this week is the defending champion in both the True Value and the Cleveland Open.
Mm-hmm. High hit, leaving the 247.
John with that open left shoulder, and then closes a little too quickly, gets a good lift on the ball, breaks too sharply and leaves a 247 as it cuts through the pins. Definitely a tough spare for the left-hander. Has to guard against the chop.
And just that, 4-7, leaving the two standing. So if you saw the semifinal match when Marshall Holman left the 4, the 4-5 combination. Here the two is left at open frame. His lead is cut to 4 with a strike up. We could have a new leader. Salvemini. Pretty strong for a non-winner. 6-pin lead.
He told me before we went into the championship round that he feels the lead, the reason he's the tournament leader is his ability to carry. Most of the players hit around the pocket, but when he hit the pocket, he carried almost 100% all week. There was a great shot. He went high, tripped out the 6-pin. That's the same shot that Petraglia had in the 6th frame, but Petraglia didn't carry it.
Lane.
This match is going down to the very last shot. These players are less than a mark apart with just 3 frames left to roll. Petraglia looking for the scoreboard on the side. John going at a 203 pace. If Joe Salvemini can convert this spare, he'll be at a 208 pace, just 5 pins difference.
Pin is blowing. The Action Track Tracer.
We spoke about it earlier. Joe Salvemini, his one problem he's had all week is inability to consistently make the 7-pin. Right here, it has put Johnny Petraglia into the lead. Unfortunate shot for Salvemini. He now trails by 7 pins. Petraglia the leader.
Back-to-back open frames in this $31,000 match. And Petraglia recovers. With that strike in the 8th frame. These last 2 games have been unbelievable, Nelson.
I agree. Good match play competition, good scoring conditions. Johnny Petraglia, the experienced, proven winner. Watch him get on this ball. He will not let this ball go. He will give it everything he has to really put Salvemini against the wall.
Seven. Boy, at all 160 pounds behind that one. Let's take a look at his reaction after the release.
Physically his best shot. He knows it's there, but he just overpowered the pins. A bad break, a solid 7. The match is up for grabs into the 10th frame, the Rolex Championship for 1983.
Though that was a classic reaction. Now he must get the 7. Foundation spare for Petraglia. And now shooting in the 9th frame, 156 through 8. trailing at this point by 7, Sal Vimini. Reno, Nevada. Pesky 7, this time on the right lane. Now he has to try to shoot that one.
Third time he's left the 7 pin. He's converted it once and missed it once. The miss has put him behind in the match. He must make this to keep any pressure on Petraglia. Salvemini going at a 196 pace with a conversion. Petraglia at a 203. It's who can double in the 10th.
He made sure that time. Giving that ball plenty of room. And like Petraglia, marking with a spare in the 9th frame. Those are the leaders by round, and like our field, starting out with variety, Turner, Carter, and Tom Baker, and then Sal Vimini taking over through rounds 4 through 6, tournament leader, and now shooting in the 10th frame of the final game.
Sal Vimini trails by 7, needs 2 strikes to take the lead. He is trailing by 7, must strike on this ball. His best shot under pressure. I don't know where these young kids come from, Chris. Remember Toby Contreras at the AC Delco? He came up in the 10th, cool as any veteran would ever be. Right now, Salvemini needs a strike to force Petraglia to double. It's going to be who can strike in the 10th frame.
And Bo, we've had a different winner every week. Competition here is fierce. Appearance of his career, Sal Vimini. And looking overhead at the score sheet, Nelson, they're unconscious.
Chris, they're just well-trained, talented, great bowlers coming out on a tour today, and the situation for Joe Sal Vimini is simply this. 7 pins makes Petraglia strike once, 8 pins or better, Petraglia must strike twice.
Finishing a game, Joe Salvemini, who has never won a title. Well, he's done his best and shot a 206.
Johnny Mastraglia must strike on the next 2 balls to win the title. One of the great clutch players of all times, once again having to prove himself.
Split. Well, in as many weeks, Bo, we have had 6 different winners, and here is another one. Joe Salvemini of Reno, Nevada, winning the $20,000 first prize, defeating the veteran Johnny Petraglia, who converted.
Honey, look at you.
The check for $20,000 and the trophy from Rick Crawl, vice president of the parent company of Rolaids, Warner Lambert Company. First time winner, Sal Vimini. Winning has become a steadfast ritual with Earl, but the last time we saw him number 1,